Shabbat Shalom, everyone. I would first like to thank Rabbi Posner and Rabbi Yogev for taking the time to work on this with me, helping me with ideas, structure, revisions, everything that goes into making a sermon, and also for being such kind, selfless mentors throughout my internship in general. And a thank you to Rabbi Wahlberg for coming and listening to it in advance and for warmly approving my internship. Miriam Bat Bilga was a priestly daughter who abandoned the Jewish faith, joined the Hellenists, and later came with them to the Beit HaMikdash, kicked the Mizbeach, the altar, and said, "Lukus, Lukus, wolf, wolf, ad matay ata mechale mamonan shel Yisrael, ve'iyat ha'omed alehem b'sha'at hadechak. For how long will you eat up the money of Israel, and you do not stand by them at a time of danger?" Think for a second, just how much chutzpah someone has to have in order to do that. It's bad enough that anybody, especially a Jew, would insult God like that, but the daughter of a Kohen, someone whose own father worked in the Beit HaMikdash, leaving behind the entire Jewish faith and siding with our enemies, the Greeks, who were persecuting us at the time? How far removed from their Jewish identity does one have to be in order to do something so horrible? To kick the Mizbeach? To contemptuously dirty God's holy table with such blatant disrespect? How could they? And so how was she punished for this heinous crime? She wasn't. It was her family that received the punishment. Let me explain something. Each priestly family had an honorary ring which could be used to hold sheep down in the Beit HaMikdash so that they wouldn't move when they were being sacrificed. When someone's ring was used for sacrifices in the temple, it was considered a great honor for the family. Each family also had a cubby to store their priestly clothing in the Beit HaMikdash. What the sages did was they stopped using their family's honorary ring and closed up their family's cubby. Suddenly, the family was now marginalized by the sages because of the acts of their daughter. But this punishment wasn't directed to her alone. Her whole family was being held responsible. When I learned this Gemara around Hanukkah time, I was very perplexed. Why was the whole family being punished for the sin of one member? Why does the group have to suffer for the crimes of the individual? And this case is not unique. It actually appears in our Parsha as well. This week's Parsha is Parsha Tazria Mitzora, which speaks all about Tzorat, a skin disease that one received in times of the Tanakh for speaking Lashon Hara. The Midrash Tanchuma explains that when one received Tzorat, first one's house was afflicted, then their clothing, and then only if they did not do Teshuvah did they then receive Tzorat on their body. The Tzorat on one's house would thus seem to be a warning to an individual to do Teshuvah, and that only if they did not take heed would their clothing and then their body also receive Tzorat. The Parsha tells us that if one's house was struck with Tzorat, then they and their family would have to take everything out of the house, live somewhere else for at least a week, replace the stones that contained Tzorat, scrape off all the coating inside the house, and then, if there was still Tzorat in the house, they would have to demolish the entire house. For a family to lose their house? Not easy. And again, the same question arises. If a person speaks Lashon Hara and deserves Tzorat, why should the whole family have to go through the trouble of taking everything out of the house, moving, and having their house demolished, all because one person in the family did something wrong? I would like to share an answer that has two sides to it, both about the effect that our families and surroundings can have on us. The truth is, that's what we say and what we do strongly impacts those around us. When answering the question as to why Miriam Bat Bilga's family was punished, Abaye explains that she must have heard such insults from her parents as a child, and that their words shaped her actions. How many times have we been in a situation where we knew we believed in something, but when around others felt ashamed of feeling that way? How often have we let others influence our thoughts or beliefs on a certain topic and stifled ourselves so as not to be the odd one out? Let's redefine Tzorat for a moment. Maybe Tzorat is less of a physical disease, but more a physical symptom of a spiritual disease that is already present. And so we must each ask ourselves, do we have tzaraat? Are we living in and sanctioning an environment where others are allowed to speak bad about one another and gossip freely? And we don't stand up to stop this evil speech? For it is not only the person who speaks evil, but also the person who hears and says nothing that gets tzaraat. The flip side of this is that a person who is punished with tzaraat must go through a much more arduous and embarrassing process than when the entire house gets struck with tzaraat. When a person is struck with tzaraat, the entire community knows exactly who it is, and their families must say goodbye to them for an indefinite period of time, 2 weeks, a month, a year, while they must suffer alone for what they have done. Compared to what happens when a person gets tzaraat, at least in the case of a home, no one person is being shamed. At least the person is suffering with others by their side who care and can go over what they did wrong so they can repent and atone for what they've done. At least the family doesn't have to separate. There is comfort in going through this experience together, supporting one another, instead of having to sit in shame all by oneself for weeks on end. True, it's unfair that the whole family has to suffer by leaving their home. But the Torah is modeling for us that it's worth the sacrifice in order to help those closest to us. The tough things that family members do for one another show how much they care for and love each other. And perhaps years later, they will look back in pride at being able to support each other through tough times. We all have this in our families. There are times when a parent is maybe sick, and so the kids have to do a little more work, like making dinner and bringing it to their parents' bedside, or when one sibling has a lot of homework, and so the other will do some of their chores for them. This happens to some degree in a community, too. There are times when a community member may have lost a loved one, and so we go pay them a shiva call and see to it that everyone saying Kaddish that year has a minyan. There are times when there's a bar bat mitzvah, and so we stay in shul a little longer, even if we would like to just go home and eat, but instead, we choose to celebrate with them and welcome them into the Jewish community. All of these are things that we do as a community that may inconvenience us, but we do them because we're a community. That's who we are, and that's what we try to live up to. Thank God, I'm grateful that at Beth Tefila, I've always felt a sense of community. I always had friends to sit next to at lunch or in class, always had people who were happy to say hi in the halls, always teachers who cared and wanted only the best for us, a wonderful, inviting congregation where my family has been warmly welcomed both by those who knew us and those who didn't, who smile and stop over and say hi almost every day, a shul with such wonderful, kind clergy who have taken me under their wing with excitement, investing so much energy into providing me with the greatest possible interning experience over the past month. These two answers to why the family suffers for one person's misdeeds point to the incredible impact one's family can have on an individual, both from a negative and from a positive standpoint. Each family member is not an island unto themselves. When one person acts out and misbehaves, many times it can be linked to the values they received from the home. The tzaraat on their homes reminds them of this. And more positively, the whole family is made to endure tzaraat on their home to note that they must always share in the pain of each member of their family. I'd like to end with a story. It's about an anonymous Major League Baseball player who visits a prison and talks to the inmates. And one of the inmates says to him, "How did you become a professional ball player, sir?" And he answers that it began with his dad, genuinely encouraging him, "You keep throwing the ball like that, son. You keep swinging the bat like that, son. And you'll end up in the major leagues one day." V'chein haya. And so it was. The inmate responded that the same thing happened to him when he was younger, except that his dad always told him that he was good for nothing and that he'd end up in prison one day. And there he was. Are we like the father of the criminal, creating a negative environment for our family? Or are we like the father of the baseball player, fostering an environment where others feel uplifted and supported, speaking in a way conducive to growth and appreciation of others, inspiring them to do good? Which one are we? May we all work hard to be the latter, uplifting one another, strengthening our families and communities, like the prophet Yirmiyahu, using our words livnot v'lintoa, to build and to plant. And to that, we can all say, Amen.